Africa, continent of contrasts in land, in people, and in ways of life. Cradle of ancient Egyptian civilization, yet home of many primitive people of today, among them the Mangbetu of the Congo region. Here in the heart of the tropical forest, with its year-round heat, its rain, and profuse vegetation, stand the orderly villages of this brown-skinned people. Homes are well built and neatly kept, for the Mangbetu emphasize cleanliness. Typical also are the father's leisure and the mother's careful preparation of cooked meals. The manioc, or cassava plant, is a major source of food and requires but little cultivation. These young girls of our Mangbetu family are collecting the tuberous manioc roots. Some varieties are poisonous when raw, but after long soaking in water and cooking, they provide a nourishing food, one form of which is our tapioca. And now to the family kitchen, where preparation of the meal continues in leisurely fashion. Into a pot of water go green bananas from the nearby gardens. The freshly gathered sweet manioc, carried in a basket woven of local reeds, will also form part of the meal for this family group. While the daughters get wooden stools, used by all Mangbetu women, father looks from his folding chair. He wears a hat, decorated with the feathers of tropical birds, and is content to wait patiently while mother prepares the manioc. A pounding process produces a pulp which will form a kind of pudding when thoroughly cooked. This Mangbetu chicken coop is built on a tall stilt foundation and has a heavy log for a door to keep out prowling forest animals such as the leopard, janet, and civet cat. Like the manioc plant and the banana, sugarcane is a part of the easily available food supply. There is little need for sweet shops where this can be done. How painstaking is the preparation of the meal? This great care with food is one of several features which makes Mangbetu culture unusually high among primitive African peoples. Another contribution to the family meal, fish, from a large stream nearby. Father tells the boys that having caught the fish, their next job is to clean them. And with a fish placed on a large tropical leaf, the task is accomplished neatly by young hands well skilled in using the sharp knife of native manufacture. When cooked, these fish will provide a tasty addition to the bananas and the manioc. Now for the meal. Food prepared in utensils made by hand from local clay. Food easily cultivated in the hot, moist climate of this equatorial region. Just as the Chinese once practiced foot-binding, and as American women once bound their waists, the Mangbetu bind their heads in the belief that this practice enhances their beauty. At a very early age, children's heads are tightly wrapped with strong cord, thus producing an elongated cone-shaped head. In the case of the women, hairdressing also receives very special attention, as we see in the Mangbetu beauty parlor. In addition to the careful grooming of the natural hair, one style of headdress calls for the application of materials which build up a high circular crown effect, which is much admired. The skill of the hairdresser is further revealed in the style seen here along with the facial tattooing, or painting with black ink, another feature of feminine adornment among the Mangbetu. Pins of ivory or monkey leg bones are a common addition to the well-dressed head. Pride in appearance is clearly evident in this confident display. There is no lack of variety in the tastes of these proud Congo women, for whom hairdressing has long been one of the fine arts. For the ivory hairpins used by Mangbetu women, elephants provide the raw material, and many other highly prized products of Mangbetu art have their beginnings in elephant tusks. This raw material will acquire a rare beauty in the ivory carver's hands. After an examination of the tusk, the artisan cuts off the end portion. For this work, the European saw has replaced that of native manufacture. The length of the hollow portion is measured, and a piece of solid ivory is obtained. This adze, produced by native blacksmith's art, is used in the rough shaping of the ivory and in the early stages of carving. The Mangbetu ivory carver is famed for his delicate skill. A skill readily appreciated by others, such as this master painter, himself an artist, and an admirer of fine workmanship. As the painter examines the work of his fellow craftsmen, he wished the deftly carved figurine were his own. Would the ivory carver trade it for the painting of his home? At least he will consider it. Now it is the painter's work that is examined, and the ivory carver is shown a variety of designs revealing the quality of the painter's art. Among the varied wall decorations, there are several patterns from which the ivory carver may choose, but the painter suggests a novel design which has an evident appeal. The agreement is sealed to the full satisfaction of the two artists. To the painter goes the ivory figurine, which will add its beauty to the interior of his home. In return, the painter makes his contribution to the beauty of the ivory carver's home. Painter and assistants carefully trace each line of the design on the sun-dried clay wall. Other assistants prepare the paints from native clay and charcoal. While the complex pattern of the design gradually develops under the practiced eye and hand of the painter, the mixing of the paint continues nearby. From lumps of an iron-bearing clay, a red-colored paint is obtained. A white clay and another made black by being mixed with charcoal are also prepared for application to the design, which is receiving its finishing touches. Applied with brushes fashioned from banana leaf stems, the paints add varied tones to the decorative scheme. Painter and assistants are in no hurry. Careful workmanship is more important than time. The painter, having already received a work of art for his labor, wishes to offer a work of art in return. And with the completion of the decoration, the ivory carver has been repaid for his skillful work. But the art of carving is not confined to the worker in ivory. Here, a maker of musical instruments practices this art as he shapes a decorative head for the neck of a stringed instrument. This neck must be accurately fitted to a sunbox previously hollowed from solid wood. After assembling the basic structure of the banjo-like instrument, the craftsman prepares to add the covering for the sunbox. This covering is of antelope skin. It will help to give a pleasing resonance to the tone. After being tightly stretched over the sandbox, the skin is sewn together at the bottom with a needle made by a Mangbetu blacksmith. The thread is of fine, strong vegetable fibers. The next step involves burning holes in the neck for tuning pegs. A young helper is heating irons for this purpose. When red hot, they will easily pierce the wooden stem. Thus, the elderly craftsman, aided by his young assistant, quickly bores the necessary number of holes for the wooden pegs. His skill is evident, for the pegs fit tightly. Next, strings of twisted vegetable fiber are carefully attached to a rib in the sandbox and to the tuning pegs on the neck. And now, after the instrument has received a final tuning, a youthful observer is allowed to use it for a trial performance. To the accompaniment of its rhythmic strains, several children join in the characteristic dance as the mellow music floats through the tranquil Mangbetu village and loses itself in the deep tropical forest.